Please join me in the call to worship that's printed in the bulletin. Oh, come, let us sing to the Lord and shout with joy to the rock of our salvation.
Let us come into God's presence with thanksgiving, singing joyful songs of praise.
Give us, rule our hearts by your Spirit, and pocket, I have a bug flashlight, because we're going to be talking about light and dark. How many of you like to sleep when it's really dark? You do? Does anybody need a nightlight? Yeah, I like the fact that I own myself too. Sometimes it's nice to have a little bit of light, because in darkness, sometimes we get scared, don't we? Thinking about Halloween, spooky things, so dark. And sometimes when it's light, it makes us feel better. So thinking about a flashlight would help us if it was really dark. I want you to think about God's love kind of being like a flashlight, because He gives us that light. He helps us see, and He helps us know what's right. Sometimes we don't always make the best choices, but if we think about what God wants us to do, put things in His light, we'll make better choices, right? Sometimes I think this, if you can think back on your week this weekend, you can think about something that you maybe shouldn't have done, but if you thought about God's light, maybe we would have made a better choice. So we want to think about, and that the Bible tells us that when we live in the light of God's love, we find that all is good and right and true. So this week, I want you to live in the good light of God's love. I want you to make good choices, and I want you to be children of the light. Think about the flashlight. Can you pray with me? Dear God, Your light makes me happy. I want to live in the light of Your love. Help me make good choices. Amen. And if you have me.
Now as we turn to God's word, let us turn first to God in prayer. Oh Lord, Your scripture tells us that we do not live by bread alone, but rather by every word that proceeds from Your mouth. And so we ask, O God, that You would feed us this morning, that You'd feed us with Your word written in Holy Scripture. Feed us with that word enacted at the table of our Lord, and feed us with the very life of Jesus Christ, the Word made flesh. We ask through Him. Amen. Our New Testament lesson today continues a series of worship lessons that we've experienced on Paul's letter to the Ephesians. And we've been following the path of Paul's argument, the first half of the letter, unfolding for us a picture of the blessing of God for us in Jesus Christ and God's intention through Christ to unite all things in the rule of Christ. Things in heaven, things on earth, all things and all people a part of that gracious, loving rule. The second half of the letter, as we started to explore last week, takes us into the consequences. What are the implications of the fact that we are being gathered together in Christ's rule? And what it means for Paul is that we would live differently from the kind of life we would live otherwise. And our lesson today and the sermon that follows will explore that kind of difference, and particularly the kind of behavior that is a part of the life of the one who's joined to God in Jesus Christ. So we listen to God's word, or we hear it from Ephesians chapter 5, starting at verse 3. Hear the word of God. Paul says, "But fornication and impurity of any kind, or greed, must not even be mentioned among you, as is proper among saints. Entirely out of place is obscene, silly, and vulgar talk. But instead, let there be thanksgiving. Be sure of this, that no fornicator or impure person, or one who is greedy, that is, an idolater, has any inheritance in the kingdom of Christ and of God. Let no one deceive you with empty words, For because of these things, the wrath of God comes on those who are disobedient. Therefore, do not be associated with them. For once you were darkness, but now in the Lord you are light. Live as children of light, for the fruit of the light is found in all that is good and right and true. Try to find out what is pleasing to the Lord. Take no part in the unfruitful works of darkness, but instead expose them. For it is shameful even to mention what such people do secretly. But everything exposed by the light becomes visible. For everything that becomes visible is light. Therefore it says, sleeper, awake, rise from the dead, and Christ will shine on you. Be careful then how you live, not as unwise people, but as wise, making the most of the time, because the days are evil. So do not be foolish, but understand what the will of the Lord is. Do not get drunk with wine, for that is debauchery, but be filled with the Spirit as you sing psalms and hymns and spiritual songs among yourselves, singing and making melody to the Lord in your hearts, giving thanks to God the Father at all times and for everything, in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ. This is the word of the Lord. The verse that precedes our passage has invited us to imitate God as God's beloved children and to live in love as Christ loved us and gave himself up for us, a fragrant offering and sacrifice to God. There is a positive exhortation for us in that verse to live as God intends us to live. And following upon that logically is this extended exhortation for us to forswear particular behaviors that do not at all accord with that way of living. And Paul, lest we accuse him of being vague or unspecific, gets right down to it. He says, but fornication and impurity of any kind, or greed, must not even be mentioned among you. And that is an interesting list, right? That fornication, sexual transgression, and sexual impurity, those first two elements in the series that he shares with us, do not belong in the life of the follower of Jesus Christ. And do not belong, therefore, in the life of the church. And I suppose that he's saying this because, as with our culture, the culture in Ephesus surrounded the believers of Jesus with all sorts of invitations to live that way. That it was a pagan culture, a culture that was hedonistic, pleasure-seeking, and a culture that didn't have a whole lot of boundaries or of rules about the right way to behave. And so those kinds of sexual transgressions would have been common in the wider culture, even, I suggest, as they are common in ours. And lest Paul not be clear, he is exceedingly focused upon that as a way of seeking to protect the people of God joined together with God through Jesus Christ. To be exceedingly clear, to say that sexual transgression and sexual impurity do not belong in the life of the church, do not belong in the life of the follower of Jesus. And I appreciate the clarity, because as I've already suggested, I believe that our culture has its own way of speaking and showing a different message than what Paul emphasizes here. And yet, anybody with eyes to see and ears to hear knows the kind of damage done in individual lives and in communal life by people who indulge in those kinds of practices. It's just not helpful. And it's wrong. And it doesn't accord with the life that God shows us and invites us to share in Jesus Christ. Now, it shouldn't be a surprise that it says that. And yet, it's important for us just to acknowledge it and to say that it does. What's interesting to me is the third element in the series, that greed is equated with, or at least linked in series, with these other two more lurid sins, that covetousness, acquisitiveness, material, is understood to be a danger to the life of the Christian and of Christian community. And I have this little refrain from Sesame Street that's going through my head, that, you know, one of these things is not like the other. Except, maybe what Scripture invites us to do is to recognize that there is similarity between the kind of appetite that's indulged as people participate in sexually immoral behavior and the kind of appetitive, acquisitive nature of those who seek to satisfy themselves with material blessings of another kind. That greed or covetousness, same basic pattern of a human being seeking to answer his or her needs on one's own power, by one's own means, and with material stuff. And that is a sin. It's a sin, we find out, because God has a better answer than that. The key for me is in verse 5, in which Paul says that no fornicator or impure person or one who is greedy, that is, parenthetically, an idolater. None of those will inherit the kingdom of Christ and of God. So the greedy one is an idolater. Idolatry is a word that we throw around a lot, but golly, we should maybe. Because we're doing it all the time. Worshipping idols. Putting in the place of the appropriate reverence that belongs to God some other lesser thing. Almost always a material thing or some cultural creation of our own making to which we devote ourselves with more energy and more focus and more attention than we do to the one who gives us life, the one in whom we live and move and have our being. How easy it is for us to confuse our devotion to God with the devotion to a number of other more accessible and more controllable things. And I know some of you are thinking about college football right now. I'll just let you sit in that for a little bit, right? Because anything by which we seek to satisfy and fulfill our lives that's not the will of God, or not essentially God's answer for us in that appetite or hunger or need, anything good can become an idol. And that idolatry is what's at the root, I believe, of the sin from which Paul warns us. So we're invited to think about our lives as lives that are different now than they would be otherwise. And we hear that in the 8th verse where Paul says that we are not to be associated any longer with these kinds of things. For once we were darkness, but now we are light in the Lord. We live as children of light, says Paul. And he has given us that kind of before and after perspective throughout the letter. In chapter 2, he has said to us that we were dead through the trespasses and sins in which once we lived, when we were under the power of the one who rules the world below, when we weren't following and under the rule of Jesus Christ. But now, because we are under the rule of Jesus Christ, we are freed from that rule that can only bring death. And we're given life, and we're joined to God in union with Christ. And because of that, our lives are different, and we're called to live differently. And it's that living differently that's the rub for us, I believe. Because the truth is that we get acculturated into the old way of living. The one that's sort of the default mode for us, that we learn apart from the grace of Christ, is that which we snap into very easily if we do not purpose to form our lives otherwise. And let's be clear, it's not that we can make our lives better that way. God gives us the grace to do that. But in our freedom, we can choose to use it or not. And Paul's reminding us, that the life that we're called to live is a beautiful life. A life that need not hang its head in shame, that need not skulk about in the shadows for fear of being exposed. That's the whole darkness and light imagery here. The scrutiny of God upon us and our lives reveals what the essence of our living is. And each one of us here knows exactly what it's like to do the thing that is not right and to feel the shame that wants to hide our deeds from others. Indeed, sometimes we want to hide them from ourselves. But the light exposes the darkness. And that's not a bad thing. That's a really good thing. The light shines in the darkness and exposes what's really there. And that's not a bad thing. It might be bad if all of a sudden that spotlight's steering towards you and you're not living the way that you know you should live. But being exposed is not the wrong thing, it's the right thing. It's a good thing. It's a gracious thing. That in Christ we are called to live a better life. That God has better for us in Christ than the kind of life that you and I would make for ourselves apart from Christ. I don't know, how were y'all doing before? How is it working for you? And why in the world are you here right now if that other life was so good? But the truth is, we need to be reminded, as Paul does here, we need to be encouraged, as we can do for each other, to live the kind of life that God wants us to live. The kind of life that doesn't have to hide. The kind of life that doesn't destroy community but builds it up. The life that ennobles ourselves and others instead of nagging at us and pulling us apart and dissipate our energies and our resources. And that life of self-indulgence, sinful self-indulgence, we think will get us somewhere, but all it does is set us back and tear apart what good we could have. And we all know that. Not a one of us here probably doesn't know of people whose lives have been hurt, or covenants that have been strained or broken by the kinds of indulgences that seemed at the time to be victimless. Oh, what a horrible lie. The great danger of a sermon like this, Justin and I were talking about this earlier, the danger of a sermon like this is, A, you would get the idea that, like, I'm somehow immune and therefore going to tell you what the deal is, and I'm not immune, okay? Or that all of us would say, oh, I'm glad that's not us, I'm glad that's them out there and not us in here, that we're nice and safe in the bubble. I guess I just want to say that Paul speaks the word to the church. It's not on the airplane banner for the pagans. It's for the church. It's for us. Because we all need to be reminded or corrected or encouraged to live that higher, better, fuller life, to recognize with increasing sensitivity the difference between what the world says is okay and what the Lord reveals is good. And the more that the world is the controlling voice for us, the more blind and deaf we will be to what the Lord reveals is good. And how is it that we have let the world get the wrong picture of God's gracious rule? How is it that the church has come across to the culture as a bunch of sanctimonious, self-righteous, puritanical, no-fun people? I mean, look at us. We're having so much fun, right?
Can I get an amen?
There's a difference between the kind of self-indulgence that titillates one or seems to promise something good, but we already know it won't do us any good, and the kind of life that is disciplined towards beauty and truth and generous love. And when we live that life, the life that God shows us in Jesus Christ, those other things lose their luster. And we ourselves can trust God's love so fully for ourselves that we have ample supply to share with others. And no one need go looking for self-fulfillment, because God is giving it to us all the time, fulfilling our lives by pouring into us the living water, the bread that once we eat will make us never hunger again. How beautiful that today we come to the table of Jesus Christ. We're invited to take Christ's life into our bodies, to feed on the bread that alone can satisfy our hunger, to drink the cup that alone can slake our deepest spiritual thirst. We will not find the answer in any created thing. Now, those created things were created by a good God who gives them to us as good gifts. It's in that God that we find the answer that fulfills us. So let us not aim anywhere lower than the highest fulfillment. that we have in Jesus Christ, our Lord. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
And please join me in saying what we believe the Apostles' Creed has printed in your bulletin, the affirmation of faith. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth,
and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Ghost, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth on the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Ghost, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting.
Jesus came to us rich, and as he was born in a stable, became very poor. So all of us who are very poor will one day become very rich. It's with that spirit that we give freely to you.
You are the Lord, we will.
gather now around the table of our Lord Jesus Christ, the life of Jesus Christ presented to us in bread and cup, a reminder for us of the sacrifice that God has made for us in the life of Jesus, and an invitation for us to share right here, right now, in that life with Him. So let us enjoy the feast which God has prepared for us. Let us keep that feast with gratitude and joy. May we join together now in prayer. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give our thanks and praise.
Holy God, Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth, with joy we praise you and give thanks to your name. You formed the universe in your wisdom and created all things by your power. You set us in families on the earth to live with you in faith. We praise you for the good gifts of bread and cup, and for the table you spread in the world as a sign of your love for all people in Christ. Great and wonderful are your works, Lord God Almighty. Your ways are just and true. Therefore, we lift our hearts in joyful praise, joining our voices with the choirs of angels and with all the faithful of every time and place who forever sing to the glory of your name.
We trust him to overcome every power that can hurt us or divide us, and believe that when he comes in glory, we will celebrate victory with him. Remembering all your mighty and merciful acts, we break bread and share one cup, giving thanks for your saving love in Jesus Christ. As you raised our Lord from death and call us with him from death to life, we give ourselves to you to live for him in joy and grateful praise. Gracious God, pour out your Holy Spirit upon us and make these your gifts of bread and wine. Make them be for us the body and blood of Christ, that we may be for the world the body of Christ, redeemed by his blood.
O God, we pray that you would bless all of those who seek your healing. And especially today we pray for Dorothy Benedict, Mary Felton, and Melinda Zeitz, and Jane Brandon. We pray, O God, for you to bless those who grieve, especially today. We think of those victims of violence in Townsville and ask that your grace and peace rest upon all affected and disturbed by that violence. We pray, Lord, for you to strengthen and bless all the missionaries and leaders in the church who raise the name of the Lord Jesus Christ in every land, and especially we pray for Rob and Tara Cahill, and Philip and Basilia Weisswanger in Guatemala. Send us out, Lord, in the power of the Spirit to live for others as Christ lived for us, announcing his death for the sins of the world and telling his resurrection to all peoples and nations. By your Spirit, draw us together into one body and join us to Christ, the Lord. that we may remain his glad and faithful people until we feast with him in glory. Through Christ, with Christ, in Christ, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor are yours, Almighty God, forever and ever, through Jesus Christ, who taught us to pray together, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever and ever. Amen.
On the night of his arrest, Jesus took the bread, and after giving thanks, he broke it. And he said, Take, eat. Whenever you eat this bread, do this in remembrance of me.
In the same way, our Lord took the cup after supper, saying, This cup is the new covenant that is poured out for you for the forgiveness of your sin. Drink of it all. For as often as we eat this bread and drink this cup, we proclaim the Lord's death until he comes again. These are the gifts of God for the people of God. Let us join in prayer. What abundant life you offer us, O God. A beautiful gift. Help us to fulfill, by your grace, the promise of this table in our daily living. And may we become as generous and as loving and as holy as you dream for us to be through the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ. that shines in the world, reflecting the glory of God and the light of Jesus Christ. And may that light illumine our lives, our hearts, and reveal every good step for us to take, that our lives will be fulfilled in the grace God gives us through Christ. And as we go, may the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ and the love of God and the communion of the Holy Spirit be ours now and always. Amen.